What if you were the first explorer to another planet? There are potentially millions of Earth-like planets in the universe that might have all the tools to create and sustain life. And if we ever work out how to get there, we're sure to at least try to explore them. It'd be an undoubtedly difficult task, but also one of the most rewarding things a person could do, becoming the first human being on an alien world. This is Unveiled, and today we're answering the extraordinary question, what if you were the first explorer to another planet? Are you a fiend for facts? Are you constantly curious? Then why not subscribe to Unveiled for more clips like this one, and ring the bell for more fascinating content. Of course, much of this question depends on what type of planet you're heading to in the first place, and what your specific aims are. Let's start with Mars, where most space agencies have their sights currently set. It doesn't have much atmosphere of its own, so the first red planet explorer would need to spend their first few hours, days, and weeks setting up artificial habitats to actually live in. Only then could they begin exploring. In fact, in the case of Mars, it'd be the task of even the first entire generations to terraform the landscapes into something that future humans could work with. And so, although the first small steps on Martian ground would signal an incredible feat in human history, it'd be decades, maybe even centuries, before any kind of Martian lifestyle could be established. But say future you gets lucky, and you're sent on an expedition to a naturally versatile alien world already capable of sustaining life. A place generally friendlier to human visitors, and by far the easier, more exciting option. Such a welcoming planet would inevitably be further away than the largely inhospitable plains of Mars, but besides the inherent dangers and obvious challenges to actually travel there, it could prove a safer option. In a time when deep space travel isn't such an insurmountable obstacle, it'd arguably make more sense to look further afield, to other star systems for the first alien worlds to jet off to, rather than simply the planets that are closest to us. Who knows, the first explorers to an especially Earth-like world might even be able to safely breathe the air, drink the water, and eat whatever crops were growing there. Regardless, on any planet, it's safety first. Even if the first explorers suspected they could eat the food, drink the water, and remove their helmets, nothing could be risked without extensively testing it first. In the meantime, you'd need a means to grow regular Earth food wherever you were, and a reliable source of definitely non-toxic water, just to be on the safe side. Luckily, in the long run, humans have proven an adaptive species up until now, so the initial safety routines needn't stand forever. That said, with a new and unknown world comes a massively increased risk of developing a new and unknown disease via exposure to alien microbes and viruses. So if you're the first explorer on an alien planet, you stand on a possibly fatal front line where you could find yourself very sick without the ability to formulate a cure. In many ways, you'd be both a famous pioneer and a walking, talking lab rat as scientists try to understand, through you, whether a new planet is fit for large-scale human habitation. You more than likely wouldn't be on your own, though. Any manned space mission involves multiple people, so for a full-length expedition to another planet, you'd be one of a balanced team of top-of-their-game experts. While the size of your team would determine the number of resources you'd need to take with you and locate once you get there, your ranks could be filled with doctors, engineers, botanists, biologists, pharmacologists, cartographers, maybe even a chef to try and make something tasty out of the alien plant life. The group will have been carefully selected whilst back on Earth and should strike up a balance to reduce the risk of loneliness, isolation, and other psychological conditions that astronauts are prone to. On the other hand, living in such close quarters with so many people is bound to cause tension. For one thing, who's going to be the Neil Armstrong of the crew, and become the very first to step foot outside? The mental strain is almost incalculable, but if you were the first explorer on another planet, you'd actually be but one of a team. Which is one reason why communication with Earth would be vital, so that mission control can monitor and hopefully resolve any conflicts that might arise. An on-Earth or near-Earth base would also prove crucial just in terms of executing the mission itself. But such a base would require currently unfathomable leaps in technology. We use radio waves to communicate with deep space probes at the moment because radio waves travel at the speed of light, but even they wouldn't suffice for a ship that's in another star system. The delays just wouldn't be manageable. Of course, if it's not the first planet we've built on, then we may well have established human outposts between it and Earth to better stream communications. But if it's not the first planet we've built on, then you also wouldn't be the first explorer on another planet. It's a problem that highlights just how difficult it would be to be the very first person on another world. Perhaps the biggest problem of all, though, would be once you've gotten there, how do you get back? The mission could well be a one-way trip. Already, many are suggesting the first missions to Mars won't feasibly include a return journey. So cast astronauts out into deep space, and that possibility is all the more likely. As a pioneering explorer, you might have to leave home knowing you'll never return or see your family again. Back on Earth, you'd undoubtedly be famous. Buildings would be named after you, people would constantly talk about you, write books about you, make films about you, but you yourself would never witness any of it. Perhaps if there was some way to communicate between Earth and your distant position, you'd be called upon to give interviews in the same way as ISS astronauts sometimes are now. But you'd be beaming back to a planet that you could quickly feel quite detached from. It's not completely hopeless, though, because if technology really had advanced enough to get you there, perhaps it would also enable you to one day return, in which case you'd be welcomed back as one of the most famous people on Earth. And even if you couldn't make it home, maybe you'd prove only the first of many to visit your far-flung destination, in which case your friends and family could reunite with you there. And perhaps even the planet itself would end up being named after you. Ultimately, the entire epic experiment would also be guided by one prominent ethical issue: whether we even have the right to build on or explore another planet at all. With some drawing parallels between our growing desire to see other worlds and the explorers in Earth's own history, there's a worry that space exploration would only lead to exploitation. If the planet you land on shows no sign of life, should it really be yours to mine, mold, and make into what Earth wants? And if there is alien life, then the questions get even more complex. Would you be seen as the invader? Would humans truly go in peace, or would war soon start up? Again, as the pioneer, as the first human visitor, you'd be the first and only link between Earth and the greatest of unknowns. Yes, you'd be famous, you'd go down in history, and you'd see sights that every other human could only ever dream of. But with that privilege would come massive risk, and you'd shoulder huge responsibility. And that's what would happen if you were the first explorer to another planet. What do you think? Is there anything we missed? Let us know in the comments, check out these other clips from Unveiled, and make sure you subscribe and ring the bell for our latest content.